So there are 41 pages in these notes, and we're on page 25, so I'm not sure the notes may have more than we actually are able to cover in the time. Let's press on. We were discussing the surgery formula for Casson's invariant. C of n. Casson. Where this is a homology three sphere. Strictly an oriented homology three sphere. And the formula was, if we have a knot K in M, then we have what's called the Alexander polynomial which is it's a Laurent series in T, but defined up to a unit. In fact, it's, as we shall see a bit more presently, it can always be, it has a sort of a symmetry property, so we can, by multiplying by a suitable power of T, we can write it in a symmetrical form. The same coefficients at positive and negative powers. So that normalizes the up to multiplying by a power of T. There's still the plus or minus one, but there is some way of normalizing that as well. So we get these integers, the coefficients of the Alexander polynomial. It is an important and well-established invariance of knots. And the formula we're discussing, Casson's surgery formula, is that if we form another manifold M1, defined by one surgery along the knot. This is again a homology three sphere, and our formula was that C of M1 is C of M plus something made out of these Alexander polynomial coefficients, the sum of J squared J. And everything we're doing is really, because we haven't pinned down the signs, everything is sort of not really, we don't need to be careful about signs because we haven't defined them anyway. But that's the shape of the formula. So we want to say something about how one can understand this. One way of understanding this is in two steps. First, we take the other surjet manifold that we called N naught. This is a homology S1 times S2. It's the same homology as S1 times S2. And then we can define a invariant like the Casson invariant, but using not strictly using flat connections, but projectively flat connections with a fixed determinant, in just the same way that we did over a surface. So we won't go into details. Just say this is defined sort of defined similarly. Using projectively flat connections. In fact, you could also discuss this in terms of flat, let's say, these projectively flat connections, the PU2 is isomorphic to SO3, so you could also talk about flat SO3 connections. So the formula then can be thought of as in two parts. First, that C of M1 is equal to C of m 0 plus C of m plus C of m 0. And secondly, a formula for this, m 0, a formula for this variant of the Kasten invariant, C of m 0, is this Alexander polynomial object. One reason for thinking of it this way, which I mentioned, is that there's a more refined theory that we won't have time to talk about, which is the Fluor homology theory of these manifolds, from which point of view the Kasten invariant appears as the Euler characteristic of the Fluor homology. And then, in fact, one reflects the fact that there's an exact triangle relating the Fluor homologies of these three manifolds. That's all we'll have time to say about that. So let's now discuss one briefly. Supposing we consider, we have our knot in some crazy way. We can take the tubular neighborhood N, which we discussed before, with boundary is a two torus. So we can consider the moduli space of flat SU2 connections over the two torus. Because the fundamental group is abelian, those all come from flat S1 connections, but we have an action of we have to divide by an action of a group of order 2. So if we take, if I take lambda lambda to the minus 1, if lambda is in a circle, is conjugate to lambda to the minus 1, naught lambda. When we go from embedding S1 in SU2, we need to divide by this action. In more general terms, the action of the Weyl group. So we form this moduli space, M, moduli space of flat connections over T2. And this is a quotient of a torus, which would be what we'd have if we just had the S1 connections, divided by this action. So this is T2 over plus or minus 1, which is S2. But this is an S2 that really comes with four special points corresponding to the four fixed points of this action. This is just the standard picture, from the point of view, of a torus as a double-branched cover of the sphere branched at four points. Mm. So we want to think of, we can think of the complement M minus N as embedded in all our three manifolds. Because we form these manifolds by taking this complement and then gluing in the solid torus in different ways. So we can look at the connections over the torus, which extend over the three different ways we've glued in the solid torus. So one of them would be, say, like this. This would be the arc consisting of the holonomy around our, let's see, so we have our two loops, the meridian and the longitude. For a flat connection to extend over our manifold M, we want the holonomy around M to be trivial. So that would just correspond to one of the axes in our T2, but when we take the quotient down here, we will get this arc joining up these two points. Another one, so that's M. If you look at M1, that will be when the holonomy around L is equal to the holonomy around M, because when we form M1, we glue in the torus so that the sum L plus M, or L minus M, the way we said it, bounds a disk in the new way we've glued in the torus. So this would correspond to the diagonal in our T2, so we would get another arc like this. So this would be the holonomy around L is equal to the holonomy around M. And that corresponds to M1. The other thing about M0, well, you might think, remember, when we form M0, we just interchange the roles of L and M. So your first thought is that we're looking at things where the holonomy around L is equal to 1. But because we're doing this variant with the projectively flat connections, actually, we take the holonomy around L is equal to minus 1. So we have this holonomy around. There is another set in the picture that we could draw. If we hadn't done this variant, if we just looked at ordinary SU2 connections, then the relevant thing would be this object where the holonomy around L is 1. So now, this is just considering the solid torus and the three ways of gluing it in, and the way it looks from the point of view of the boundary. Now, if we think about the interesting part, which is this whole complement of the knot, we have some, say, gamma. It's a set of equivalence classes of representations of pi 1 of this knot complement, m minus m. M minus k, or quadruci classes of these. And in the same way that we said that, roughly speaking, these spaces of the flat connections over a closed three manifold, in a sense, have dimension 0, in the sense that you make a generic projection perturbation, they have that property. This is similarly, this has got virtual dimension 1, as you can see. Well, as we can suppose, perhaps awfully perturbing the situation in some way, this is a one-dimensional object. So clearly, we can take one of these things and restrict it to this torus, and the solutions of the problems we're trying to study correspond to the intersection of that restriction with these various sets that we've drawn. All we're saying is that a flat connection over M is given by taking a flat connection over M minus N and a flat connection over N, which agree on the boundary. So that's the basic principle we're using. So this is a sketch because there are quite a few details one would want to see. The image of this thing, gamma, is some one-dimensional set inside our moduli space. It needn't actually be a manifold because we do have complications with the reducible connections, but they will occur here. This is why we didn't use this one, because there is a whole family of reducible connections in the knot complement, and the irreducible ones can bifurcate out from that. So we might have some kind of picture like this. So this thing could actually have endpoints at certain reducible connections, something like that. But that doesn't matter for our argument, because what we want to say is that in counting these three things, the Cassiter variant of M and of M1, and this modified version for M0, we're counting the intersection points of the green curve with the three sides of the triangle. Not naively counting the number of ways we can build a flat connection over M is counting the number of ways we can take one on the complement and one on the tubular neighborhood that match up, which is the intersection points here. And I hope you'll believe that everything can be done with sines and so forth and transversality, so that the counts we're doing strictly correspond to the sort of homological intersection number of these things. And the fact that the triangle is a boundary of something implies that we get the linear, this relation between the intersection numbers of the three sides. Does that make sense as an outline argument?
Can you say again the relation of the three sides of the triangle with the gluing construction?
That if we just focus on one gluing construction, we're writing, say, M is M minus N union N. So we're saying that if we have a flat connection over M, we can restrict it to the two pieces, and we'll get a pair that match over the intersection.
Yes.
And that corresponds to the intersection. So the flat connections over N correspond to the ones where the holonomy around the meridian is trivial, which is because you need to extend over the little disk. So the intersection points here correspond to that counting these, the way you can build a connection in this decomposition. But in just the same way, for these other things, we get the intersection points of the other sides of the triangle. So the fact that we have a homotopy in this representation variety between this thing and the sum of these things gives us this formula. And I said we're not defining signs. So if you said you wanted to make this, the sum of them all should be zero, that would be fine, because we haven't even specified the signs. Okay, so that's our sketch of one. Let's simply go to the sketch of two. And that we can relate that to going back to our study of the homology of moduli spaces of bundles over surfaces. So what we're going to say has some other motivation from that point of view. So they're related to H star of NG. You could use homology or cohomology, wouldn't make any difference. So before we talked about we studied this cohomology. What we studied was the top dimensional pairings. We said we looked at classes you could write down as products of the standard generators and evaluating them on the fundamental class. Here we want to, what we want to study is this as a representation of the group of diffeomorphisms of sigma. If we think of this as essentially representations of the fundamental group, then up to some slight complications, these diffeomorphisms act on this moduli space, and so they act on the homology. So there are quite well-known descriptions of the rational homology, the Poincaré series of this moduli space. So, and these can be derived in various ways. That's one way. It was developed by Attia and Bott. It involves a stratification of the space of connections modulo the gauge group. Actually, their approach goes through equivariant cohomology, so it'd be better to talk about the space of connections, but with the action invariant under the action of the gauge group. But we're not going to be able to get to that level of detail. So roughly speaking, we have an open stratum which retracts onto just our moduli space n sigma. So these just correspond to the stable bundles. As we said, any connection over our Riemann surface defines a holomorphic bundle. We can look at the ones that are stable, and that's an open set. Then we have higher strata, which retract onto copies of the Jacobian torus, J. Because these correspond to bundles that are not stable. If a bundle is not stable, then it comes with a destabilizing sequence, which, because we're talking about rank 2 bundles, that just involves a line bundle, and so we get essentially an object in the Jacobian, the moduli space of line bundles. And so we're talking always about the fixed determinant version. So we're only going to have time to give a very schematic version of this. You can read up in other places the details if you're interested. But the rough picture, if we draw a picture of our A mod G, down here we have our moduli space N, the flat connections. We have an open set which can be retracted onto N, and then we have some higher strata, all of which retract onto copies of the Jacobian. So we can take, we have various copies of the Jacobian which just correspond to taking direct sums of line bundles, and then we have higher strata that retract onto these. In fact, this can be thought also in terms of the Morse stratification, as it's called, defined by the norm of the curvature. The norm of the curvature is a minimum, in fact, zero, on this moduli space N, and then we have those higher critical points. So recall we have these classes A in H2. We said H2 of the space of flat connections, but in fact these are all defined over all the, say, A mod G irreducibles, say, all the irreducible space of all equivalent cells and irreducible connections. Similarly, we have B in H4, the same space, and then we had a map from H1 of sigma to H3 of this space. And it's actually quite easy to show that if we take this infra dimensional space of all irreducible connections and work with rational cohomology, then the cohomology is freely generated by these things. So it's the tensor product of the polynomial algebra generated by A and B, and the exterior algebra generated by the odd part, by this thing. So H star A mod G irreducible is freely generated as a ring by these classes. Is that clear what I mean? That it's just the ring generated by these Lattery relations. Apart from the commutation, it's a graded commutative ring. So apart from the commutation relations that come from that. So we want to discuss what's called the Poincaré polynomial, which is just a gadget for encoding the Betti numbers. So that's just the sum of dim hi of n sigma t to the I. Let's go back to writing ng, where g is the genus of our surface. So the idea is that that's given by, we know this, so we first of all write the prime and Poincaré series of this thing. But what will that be given? We have the polynomials generated by A, that would give us 1 over 1 minus t squared. Because when we invert, we get 1 plus t squared plus t to the fourth and so on, which just gives all the powers of A. Then we have the part we have B, another generator, so we get 1 over 1 minus t to the fourth. And then we have the exterior algebra generated by the image of these things, which live in H3, and that will give us 1 plus t cubed to the 2g. So this would just be the Poincaré polynomial of polynomials in two variables in degrees 2 and 4, and this exterior algebra generated by things in degree 3. But in this dense open subset of this space retracts onto N, but we have the other pieces. So the recipe is we have to subtract off contributions from the other pieces. So these other pieces, they contain the homology, because they retract onto this Jacobian, they contain the homology of the Jacobian. I seem to be. So that's 1 plus u to the g. And in fact, they have the kth, so these things that have infinite number copies laid by an integer, so k equals 1. K equals 0, K equals 1, and so on. And these have codimension 2g plus 4k, the kth one, it turns out. So the way these things work is, this should have been t, we need to shift the homology by the amount depending on the codimension. So we put in t to the 2g plus 4k. Well, then there's something else because the fact we're working with these things here, these things here these actually consist of reducible connections. So the link around them in the space of irreducible connections will be a copy of CP infinity. I say this is all better explained if one works with equivariant cohomology. But the upshot is that the contribution to the cohomology that you get from these higher strata needs to be multiplied by the cohomology of the stabilizer group, which the classifying space of the stabilizer group, which is CP infinity. So the upshot is that we get another 1 plus t squared on the denominator. Well, this is very extremely sketchy, but it's an interesting thing to study. But this is a true formula for what we get out to describe the Betti numbers, the dimension of the rational cohomology of this moduli space, which was found in this way by a theorem Bott, and was found also by applying the Vey conjectures to relate to counting points in the moduli space over finite fields, and many other ways. But always give the same formula, of course. So we can perform this is just this geometric series, and we're going to get another, we get the same thing, because we've got 4k in here, we're going to get another term involving this same denominator. So this is 1 over 1 minus t squared, 1 minus t to the fourth. Then we just get 1 plus t cubed to the 2g minus 1 plus t to the 2g. So it's not immediately obvious that this thing is a polynomial. These are, on the right-hand side, we just have power series, but of course that's true. So from this, this strongly indicates a formula, which turns out to be correct, for what these things are as representations of the diffeomorphism group, as we said. So if we plot lambda r is lambda r of h1 of sigma, it's the ordinary exterior powers, then, if you think for a moment, you'll see that the formula that this suggests is that if we just schematically remove the dimensions, we write the sum of hi of ng times t to the I is equal to the same thing, 1 over 1 minus t squared, 1 over 1 minus t to the fourth, times the sum of lambda r t to the 3r minus t to the 2g plus r. So r bigger than equal to 0. In the sense that this is a polynomial with coefficients that are vector spaces. So, or virtual sums of vector spaces. If you expand this out, take the coefficient of t to the I, that'll be some linear combination of these lambdas, and the statement is that this homology group, as a representation of the diffeomorphisms, should be isomorphic to the corresponding sum of the exterior powers, as the representation is. So if you stare at it for a minute, if I write it down right, you'll see that this formula would give this formula for the dimensions from the way that the leave you to work that out. And that could be tidied up by changing the gradings in both the exterior powers and these homology groups to change the zero of our gradings to be the middle dimension. This is a So let's put script hi. This is going to be h3g minus 3 minus I of n sigma. You could, by the well-known, this is a Kähler, compact Kähler manifold, so by well-known identities, you get the same thing if you put plus I here. Isomorphism. And let's put lambda, what are we putting? Lambda j in brackets is equal to lambda g minus j. Now we're just changing the way we're organizing the indexing in the two sides. But now you find that the formula changes to saying that the sum of hi t to the I is equal to the sum of t to the 2j minus t to the minus 2j, t to the j minus t to the minus j over t squared minus t to the minus 2, t to the minus t minus 1 times lambda j. So now we're this is a sum over I and Z, and this is a sum over J and Z. Because our indices can run over positive and negative signs. So now, miraculously, the genus has disappeared. So this is a sort of a universal formula for how to write this homology group of our moduli space. In terms of exterior bars, it becomes universal, independent of the genus, when we use this renormalization, this grading about the middle dimension. Is it making sense? This is the notation that I'm using here. Is it making sense? We expand this out in a formal way. We'll get something which is a sum of linear combinations of these things times powers of t. And we're saying this thing is isomorphic as a representation to the corresponding sum of these things. Okay. But now supposing we forget the grading on this side, we just want to take the sum of all the homology. Well, actually, later we're going to take the sum of the even and odd homology, but we're just going to retain the Z2 grading. That will just pop out in a convenient moment. So if we just look at the sum of Hj, that corresponds to putting t equals 1 in this formula. Just looking at the sum of all the homology. T equals 1 in this formula. Of course, these are not defined, but in the ordinary way, if you think of expanding this out as a power series, you're just going to get the sum of j squared lambda j. So this is a true formula, the correct formula. It turns out, because one needs to do some work to establish this, but it's the formula that obviously ought to be true from the way things go. It turns out it's a correct formula for the sum of hi as a representation of diff sigma. So if you accept that, then you can almost immediately get, you can see why this formula for this Casson-like invariant should be true, at least in the special case of what's called fibered knots. So a fibered knot is one where m minus k, or m minus n, fibers over the circle, with fiber some punctured, well, it's been sigma minus k, sigma minus a point, the fiber a punctured surface. So certainly not all knots have this property, but some do, like the standard trefoil knot. It's a fibered knot, for example, with sigma a torus. So when you form M0 by gluing in the solid torus in a different way, that just corresponds to filling in these points. So M0 similarly is just the corresponding bundle with fiber, the closed surface over the point. So our picture will be something like this. We're looking at a mapping torus of some diffeomorphism F from sigma to sigma. The mapping torus. We take sigma times an interval and glue the ends together using F. So, just as a set, what are the, well, strictly we're not talking about flat connections because we have this PU2 business, but these sort of modified flat connections over M0, in that case, correspond precisely to the fixed points of the induced map on N sigma. So we have an induced map, let's call it NF, from N sigma to N sigma. And we're looking at the fixed points. Because for just the same reason as when we did our previous gluing constructions, if we have these modified flat connections over the whole thing, we can restrict it to sigma, but then as we go round, we've got to come back to the same thing as we follow around. So we have to have a fixed point of this induced map on the moduli space. Does that make sense? Let's forget the fact that imagine we're working with actual flat connections, then we're saying. This will become a purely algebraic statement that we're forming. We have pi 1 of M0 goes to Z, goes to pi 1 of sigma. What do you want to say? We can form a completely algebraic statement in terms of the representations of the fundamental group. This extension, if we have this automorphism of sigma, we have an automorphism pi 1 of sigma, and then this purely algebraic way of writing down this extension, and we'll just be talking about the representations of the fundamental of the group, of this group, we give them the representations of this group that are fixed by this automorphism. So when we want to count these fixed points, assuming the signs will work out, which we haven't defined anyway, then what we're looking at is the Lefschetz number of this map. So C of n CUM, CUM naught is equal to the Lefschetz number of NF to N sigma goes to N sigma. Which is recalled, so the basic Lefschetz theorem is that we have a number that we can, given by counting the fixed points of F with suitable signs, but also given by the alternating sum of the traces of the action on homology. So this is plus or minus the sum of minus 1 to the j, the trace of Fj, say, where Fj is the map from our Hj to Hj induced by N of F. Is everyone familiar with this Lefschetz formula for how you count the fixed points of a map in terms of? So on the other hand, these things are equal to the sum of j. This is so this is just the graded trace of the action on. So this is the graded trace. So it's the trace. The action on the graded trace. The action on the sum of these H's. And this corresponds to the corresponding sum here. So this is the sum of J squared and minus 1 to the J times J squared times the trace of the induced map on the lambda j. Phi j, say, where phi j is the map from our lambda j to the lambda j. So the final part of the story in the case of pivot maps is that the coefficient, so it follows from the definition, that the psi j, the trace of psi j, is minus 1 to the j times aj, the coefficient of the the coefficient of the Alexander polynomial. In fact, the Alexander polynomial in this fibered situation, the Alexander polynomial is just given by the characteristic polynomial of the action on H1. In fact, delta t is t to the minus g times the determinant of let's see, n of f star minus t, where n of f star from h1 sigma to itself is the induced map. I don't put the n's in here. Induced map. Remember, we said that the definition of the Alexander polynomial involved writing down a presentation matrix for the homology of this universal cover as over the ring of Laurel's series. In this fibered situation, the universal cover is just R times sigma. So the homology is just the homology of sigma. And if you follow through the definitions, you end up just writing down the ordinary characteristic polynomial, the determinant of the induced action on H1. So you see these, the fact that we get this symmetry property follows from the fact that this thing preserves the symplectic form on the H1. If you take any symplectic map like that, the coefficient, the characteristic polynomial has this symmetry property. And the coefficients are just given by the trace of the action on these exterior powers, usual. As in the usual exterior algebra theory. Okay, so in the notes, I say a bit more about how to extend this approach using the ideas of. Perhaps we'll do that now. In the notes, I talk a bit about what's called topological field theories and how to extend this approach from the case of fibered knots to general knots. But I think we won't say anything more about that, because really we ought to get on to dimension 4 now. So we'll have our break for 5 minutes, and then we'll come back and start our final section on gauge theory in 4 dimensions.
Some kind of function class of the product of find any state or bundle over the surface, and then I just take a point in N, and then I restrict to the point across the surface, and then that would be a bundle over the surface. So just pretend this is actually a rectangle bundle that I can restrict to by instance.
Is there like an algorithmic way to see if a knot is fibered in the presentation?
Kasson's original argument was quite different. Maybe it was somehow some level of the set. In the notes, I sketch it.
Right.
You're out of time.
Sure.
But you can kind of see the role of the homology of the set. So we finally got to dimension 4. A bit later than I hoped, but we have some time to talk about that. And in a sense, that this will be the first time we start dealing with differential geometry, because most of the time we talk about flat connections, or more or less so far. So nothing really interesting locally happening, but as we've seen, globally interesting connections with algebraic geometry and topology. So this is our section 4, dimension 4. And the main thing that I hope to talk about here, if the timing goes roughly right, is something called the ADHM construction of instantons. So we should be able to focus on that next week. But let's begin by reviewing just some special features of four-dimensional geometry, or algebra, anyway, which we talked about, some of this we talked about rather briefly in the end of the first lecture. So let's suppose we have a V. So let's just say, so we can think as R4, an oriented four-dimensional Euclidean vector space, real vector space. So what we have then is a star operator from lambda 2 of V star, which satisfies star squared is equal to 1. Remember, you always have this star operator on the forms on the Euclidean space going between complementary dimensions. In four dimensions, two is the middle dimension. So this is what we have. So that means we can write lambda 2 of V star is equal to the sum of two spaces, say lambda plus direct sum lambda minus, called the spaces of self-dual or anti-self-dual forms, the eigenspaces of star. And from the way this star operation is defined, by comparing the metric and the wedge product, another way of saying this is that if we have alpha, which is a decomposition alpha plus plus alpha minus into self-dual and anti-self-dual parts, then alpha wedge alpha is alpha, the norm of alpha plus squared minus the norm of alpha minus squared times the volume element. Yes. That's part of it, but that this is the way that you define star by comparing the wedge quadratic. You have a quadratic form given by the wedge product, and a quadratic form given by the inner product, and star is defined by comparing the two. Now, in terms of representations, we have the special orthogonal group acts on V, or SO4, you can think of it. That also acts on lambda plus and lambda minus, preserves the natural metric that they inherit from natural metric on two forms. So we have a map from SO4 to SO3 times SO3. And this is a local isomorphism. That's a 2-to-1 map. It induces an isomorphism of Lie algebras. So this is one way of saying that if we take the group spin 4, which is the double cover of SO4, that corresponds to the double covers the two copies of spin 3, which we identify with SU2. So spin 4 is equal to SU2 times SU2. So we have a fourfold covering map from this to this, which factors through SO4, a pair of double covering. So to write down spin structures explicitly in four dimensions, we can say, supposing we're given spaces S plus, S minus, so these are two-dimensional complex Hermitian vector spaces with complex symplectic forms. There was lambda 2 of S plus or minus has got some fixed isomorphism with C. And then we also have a Hermitian form. So if we're given a pair of such spaces, we can think of this by putting together the complex symplectic form and the Hermitian metric in a standard way, we can define a antilinear map, say J plus or minus, from S plus or minus to itself. J plus or minus squared is equal to minus 1. This is antilinear. Just by combining the structures we have in a standard way. So in fact, we can think of, another way of saying it is, we can think of these as one-dimensional quaternionic vector spaces, because we can use the complex structure and these J's to define a quaternionic structure. And in fact, the group SU2 is the same as the group SP1 of unit quaternions. If we were saying that. So now let's look at, say, right, this HOM R of S minus S plus is the set of maps F from S plus to S minus, which is C linear, and let's say J, so S minus to S plus, there we go, J plus composed with F is equal to J. If I first do J minus, then I do F. F composed with J minus is equal to J plus. So it's the same as looking at the quaternion linear maps between these vector spaces. So you might think that's a quaternionic vector space, but it's not. This is only a real vector space, and in fact it's a four-dimensional real vector space, as you easily see. And it has, you can easily write down, in terms of the structures you have on S minus and S plus, the standard orientation and Euclidean form on this space. So a spin structure in four dimensions, you can think of as saying you're given these spaces, the spin spaces, S plus and S minus, and an isomorphism of your original vector space V with this thing. The iso. V goes to. So this is a way of thinking, this is what a spin structure is. Because clearly then, these groups of symmetries of S plus and S minus, they're each copies of SU2, they act on this space here, so they act on V, and that just gives the double covering from this thing to SO4. So if we want to be more explicit, if we think of it of V as R4 with coordinates x0, x1, x2, and x3, then we could take the standard basis V to the corresponding maps gamma0, gamma1, gamma2, gamma3, which in standard bases for these two-dimensional complex spaces will be written in terms of 2x2 complex matrices. And we would take, we could take the matrices one, these ones. So. If you want to write everything down more explicitly, we could use this description. So now, how does this spin discussion interact with this discussion of the self-dual and anti-self-dual forms? Well, we can see that from this, really, that we know that the two spin spaces, which correspond to these two SU2 factors, should correspond to the self-dual and anti-self-dual forms that correspond to these two SO3 factors. But how does it work more explicitly? So if I have a pair of vectors v1 and v2 in V, then I can take gamma of v1, which way around are we doing it? Gamma star of v2. So this will map, so this maps, the gamma star maps S plus to S minus, this maps S minus to S plus. So this is S plus to S plus. So this is, if you look at it, this is skew symmetric in V1 and V2. So it induces a map from lambda 2 to the endomorphisms of S plus to S plus. But in fact, it vanishes on the anti-self dual factor. So this induces an iso from lambda plus is isomorphic to SU of S plus. Perhaps we should. So we have S plus, we have a corresponding copy of the special unitary group, the automorphisms of S plus that have unit determinant and preserve the metric. So this is the same as the isomorphism between R3, if we like, thought of as a Lie algebra, and the Lie algebra of SU2. But this is a sort of. Expressed in a basis independent way. And similarly, of course, we have lambda minus is isomorphic to SU of S minus. But another way of saying that is that this thing can be identified with certain trace-free, let's see. So another way of expressing that is equivalently, we have a quadratic map say Q, this would be rather important to what we're going to do, which takes S plus to lambda plus. So we want, if I'm given an element phi in S plus, I want to write down an element of this space of endomorphisms of S plus. So I can take phi phi star. Yeah. So this is the element of the dual space defined using the Hermitian metric. So this thing is the endomorphism of S plus, I multiply by I, and I take 0, which means the trace-free part. And so this thing lies inside SU of S plus, and our map Q takes it, maps to the corresponding element of lambda plus. Maybe later we'll write this down in some different ways, in explicit formulae, but let's not take time to do that now. Is it clear what I mean by this? If you have, think of as a phi as a column vector, or row vector or something, and you make the 2x2 matrix done like that. So that expresses the basic algebra that we want to discuss, the relation between our vector space V, the exterior powers and the splitting and the spin splices. Everything is defined by these structure maps, gamma, and, well, this map Q will play a role. So another thing we have then is the Dirac operator. So in this, let's use the notation, let's write D of the Dirac operator from negative spinners to positive spinners. So we'll write D star for the the adjoint operator, which goes in the other way, s plus to s minus. So this Dirac operator d, we can think is just given by d is just the sum of gamma I d by dxi, explicitly. If we think of intrivializations, we think of these things as just vector value functions, functions of values in C2, we form this operator by using these matrices, differentiating in the coordinate directions. It's an explicit description of the Dirac operator. So the last thing we want to say about this sort of very basic stuff is what happens if we fix a complex structure. So here we have a real vector space. We picked up these complex vector spaces as the spin spaces. V is a real vector space. Now suppose that V actually gets provided with a complex structure compatible with the metric and orientation. That's reflected in decompositions of certain of these spaces, but in fact only decompositions in the plus part with our standard orientations. So now consider compatible complex structure on V. So now we have V becomes itself a two-dimensional Hermitian complex vector space, and we can think of the complex structure in terms of the Hermitian structure in terms of form omega, so the metric form, in the standard way that if you have a metric and a complex structure, you can put them together to make a two-form. So what happens now is that lambda plus decomposes as the span of omega, so this metric form is a self-dual form, direct sum of piece which we identify with lambda 0, 2. Another way of saying it, you take in the complexification, you take lambda 0, 2 plus lambda, and then you take the real part of that. But by taking something in lambda 2 and adding on the complex conjugate, that's another way of saying it. Whereas lambda 1, 1, so lambda minus is just, from the complex point of view, the space of real 1, 1 forms. So it doesn't decompose at all. So the crucial point, then, is that if we have an anti-self-dual form, a form where alpha plus is 0, then the 0, 2 part of that form is 0 for any complex structure. It has type 1, 1, any complex structure. What happens in terms of spinners? If you said, remember, spin structures don't come intrinsically with your vector space. There's some extra little bit of structure that you have to have. In this complex picture, that extra bit of structure is a square root of what's called the canonical line. So if you write K, as the standard notation, is the top exterior power of the coat of T star regarded as a complex vector space V, then a spin structure means a choice of a square root of that line, a line whose tensor square is canonically identified with K. And then what happens is that S plus is just given by well, let's just write it this way. It's given by C direct sum lambda 0, 2 tensor k to the 1/2. We've got the sign red. And S minus is just lambda 0, 1 tensor k to the 1/2. So, if you like, this is just the factor you need to put in to make the top exterior power of these things canonically trivial. And the map gamma is given by the standard expressed in this complex point of view. We have these pens are working. We have a standard sequence we can write down of maps from C. If I have any V, I can sort of wedge with V to get to here, and I can wedge with V again to get with here. The map gamma is given by taking, we want to take this map, direct sum, the adjoint of that one, tensor with k to the 1/2, to get our structure map between the spin spaces. Similarly, the Dirac operator has a description in terms of complex geometry. Just working, I'm just discussing things in the flat situation now over R4 or C2, if you like. Similarly, is the Dirac operator is D bar plus D bar star, where we take our Dolbo complex twisted by k to the 1/2. So we take omega 0, k to the 1/2, maps to omega 0, 1. K to the 1/2, the D bar operator, and then another D bar operator, omega 0, 2. Serious problem with the pens today. So we mean we take this D bar operator and the adjoint of this one to get a map from the negative spinners, which are these correspond to this thing, to the positive spinners, which are the sum of this thing and this thing. But finally, what is the space of choices of a compatible complex structure on V? Just write the space of complex structures. Well, from one point of view, it's given they're all equivalent under SO4. And if I take the standard one, its stabilizer is by definition U2. So it's the homogeneous space SO4 over U2, which is a two-sphere. In terms of our description, it's on the one hand, the unit sphere in lambda plus is a three-dimensional real vector space, so it has a unit sphere, which is a copy of the two-sphere. On the hand, it's the projectivization of S plus. If I fix a complex structure, I've picked out a preferred self-dual form, that gives my description in terms of this unit sphere, and then I've picked out a preferred subspace of the spin space given by this space. So that gives my description in terms of this. So one of the main points we need to take away from this, though, is that a form alpha is in lambda minus if and only if alpha 0, 2 equals 0 for all complex structures. You know, it's one direction is clear and the other direction is easy to check. But the converse is true if, well, both directions are pretty much clear from this we've said. Okay. So that's our background sections on special features of four-dimensional geometry. Are there any questions about that at this point? So if not, let's go on to talk about the Yang-Mills instanton equations, which we can motivate by paying a bit more lip service to the background of all these ideas in field theory, in particle physics. Remember, we mentioned the standard model that involved a connection on a bundle and sections of various associated bundles and spinners and things. Another thing that involves involved in this model is what's called the Lagrangian, which will be, you know, it's a very complicated thing involving contributions from all these different terms. But the contribution from the connection is quite straightforward and just corresponds to the L2 norm of the curvature. So now we're supposing we're working over, say, a compact Riemannian manifold. So the S of A is equal to the L2 norm squared of the curvature. That's been the integral at each point. If I have a Riemannian metric, I can work out the norm, the curvature in a standard way, and I integrate with these in the volume form. So in quantum field theory, functional integrals like e to the minus beta s of a occur. More precise, if we were saying in any more detail, we would also talk about all the terms that correspond to the other fields, but we don't do that. So this would be some sort of functional integral over the space of connections. And, of course, as is well known, such integrals are not necessarily, maybe no one knows how to define this in a rigorous way, mathematically, but at least in some schematic level. But an important thing you see is beta is a parameter, is that whatever this integral should mean, when beta is large, this integral should be concentrated on the minima of S of A. So beta goes to infinity, they concentrate on the minima of S of A. But whatever meaning this thing has, you imagine it ought to have that property. And in fact, quantum field theory, for example, gives some prescriptions for expanding this out as a series for large, an asymptotic expansion for large values of beta, in terms of calculations that you do over the set of minima. But as I said, we're only paying lip service to all of this. All we're going to take away from this is motivation for defining the Yang-Mills instantons, which are the absolute minima of this Yang-Mills functional. So let's just review how that goes. So we have a compact manifold. We consider, say, an SUR bundle, say. This is compact Riemannian oriented. So then we have one of these characteristic classes for SUR, which is the second Chern class, which we can express in terms of any choice of connection, as we said. So the fact we take 8 pi squared times the second Chern class, this is the integral of, I think the formula I wrote down before was quite likely wrong by a sign. Right? This is the right sign, f wedge f, for any connection A. So this is, we're combining the wedge product with the trace and, well, essentially with the Killing form, with the natural quadratic form on the Lie algebra. When we use our basic formula for the wedge product term, then this turns out to be the integral, this is the norm of f minus squared. We write f is equal to f plus plus f minus in self-dual and anti-self-dual parts. Remember, f is a bundle value of 2 form. We decompose the 2 forms into the 2 pieces. And it follows from our discussion from a few minutes ago that this is the L2 norm of f minus squared minus the L2 norm of f plus squared. So the L2 norm of f is at least the L2 norm of f minus, which is, if C2 of p is positive, say, we can do the other choice by just changing orientation, then this is at least 8 pi squared. The second Chern class, with equality, if and only if f plus is equal to 0. This difference has to be a certain size to give us the topology. To minimize the energy, we don't have any wasting by contribution both terms. You want to have all the energy going into the f minus part. So that's the motivation that we'll take for defining the anti-self-dual Yang-Mills instantons, or just instantons, to be connections satisfying this condition. The curvature is an anti-self-dual form. There is an instanton. If f plus of a is equal to 0. So what we immediately see is that if M is a complex manifold, it has a complex structure compatible with we always choose a Riemannian metric compatible with that complex structure, then by what we've said, this will imply if F plus is 0, then F 0 to 2 is 0. So by one direction of this correspondence, we will get a connection with 0 2 parts of the curvature 0. By our integrability theorem that we mentioned before, that will induce a holomorphic structure on our bundle. So if M has a complex structure, an instanton on a bundle, switching to vector bundle language, say E goes to M, induces a holomorphic structure on E. Remember, when we were working on Riemann surfaces, there was no integrability condition, so any connection defined a holomorphic structure. When we go to higher dimensions, there is an integrability condition, but it'll automatically be satisfied if we're working with these instanton equations. So this is the equation that we want to talk about for the next, we've got 2 hours and 15 minutes, for the end of, that's 2 hours and 10 minutes to allow for our 5-minute break next week. If we have any time, we may talk a bit about the Seiberg-Witten equations, which are some other equations built out of some similar ingredients. But even if we don't, there's something about those in the notes. So we will talk, we will say something, I hope, about the applications of these equations in four-manifold topology, but they have interest from many other points of view. In particular, they're connected to the theory of integrable systems. So in some sense, this equation is integrable in that you can, in a certain sense, write down the general local solution. Procedures for constructing the general local solution. So let's just put the integrability aspect of the instance of equation. And this is connected to the fact that, and let's write it down. Let's not say that. So, for example, many well-known integrable equations in the same sense, such as the KdV equation and so on, can be obtained as reductions in a certain way of this instanton equation. So let's just illustrate that by considering Nahm's equation. So e.g., just to take up the last few minutes. So we want to just consider a connection. Working on R4, I'll take a connection, the sum of Ti of x naught dxi, so I equals 1 to 3. So I'm letting my connection matrices, well, in the x naught direction, there's no. We set the connection matrix to zero. That can always be achieved just by a gauge transformation. The other ones only depend upon the coordinate a naught. So our covariant derivatives are grad naught is d by dx naught. And for I bigger than naught, grad I is just ti. So, I'm slightly running together two different things I was planning to say. If we write down in R4 this anti-self-dual condition explicitly, it will become that equals 0, where ijk are cyclic. So if we take ijk to run over cyclic permutations of 1, 2, 3, we write down these equations, and those are just the conditions that are formed is anti-self-dual. And these things can be written as the commutators of the corresponding covariant derivatives. So write this grad 0 grad I plus grad j to k is equal to 0. So what do we get here? When we commute the grad 0 with grad I, we just get the derivative of this matrix valued function Ti of x naught. So
we'll get d by dx I as well.
I want to put d by dx I plus Ti, but the Ti only depends upon x naught. That's the point. So when I take the commutator of two of these, I don't get any term from differentiating because that's what we should write. So the equation that I get when I make this reduction is an ordinary differential equation. It's called Nahm's equation. So if we write, say, x naught is equal to S, say, maybe more familiar, we get the equations dTi ds is tj bracket tk. These are equations for a triple of matrix-valued functions of one variable. So these are nonlinear, a system of nonlinear ODEs. And of course, you can write down many systems of nonlinear ODEs. You wouldn't normally be able to expect to be able to solve those ODEs in any explicit way. But in the case of Nahm's equations, you can. And that illustrates this aspect of what I'm trying to talk about of the instanton equation. So let's just see how that goes in the next 5 minutes. So if I take d by ds of t1 plus it2, that is equal to I T3 bracket T1 plus I T2. If I take two of these equations are equivalent to this equation, taking the real imaginary parts. Is everyone? So as we get dt2 ds is the bracket of it's the imaginary part, that's the bracket of t3 with t1. And dt1 ds is minus the bracket of t3 t2, which are these equations. Well, that has a natural meaning. It says that the conjugacy class of t1 plus it2, it doesn't change. This T1 plus IT2 evolves with S within the same orbit under conjugation. Particularly, the eigenvalues of T1 plus IT2 are unchanged with S. Independent of S. So there's a whole language in the theory of integrable systems about writing equations in lax form, in this kind of commutator form, in which case the eigenvalues are invariants. But this, we got this just, this whole thing is invariant under SO3, naturally. We got this by singling out two directions. So there's a whole family of similar equations that we can write down. In fact, naturally parameterized by a two-sphere, the same two-sphere of complex structures that we talked about. But we can, in turn, we can think of that two-sphere as the Riemann sphere, C with a point at infinity. So this family of equations is, if we take a variable zeta in C, and we write down A of zeta, also depending upon S, that's going to be 1 plus zeta squared t1 plus I 1 minus zeta squared t2 minus 2i zeta t3. And you find from the equations that if you look at dA, ds is the bracket of A with something else, minus I T3 plus zeta times T1 minus I T2, if you go through the calculation. So the same thing that we said, what we said for T1 plus I T2 is true for each zeta, for the corresponding A of zeta. And we've expressed that by saying that these eigenvalues are given by, we take the determinant of A of zeta S minus eta. This is a complex curve, which just expresses for each fixed value of zeta, this is just looking at the spectrum of the corresponding matrix. And this is independent of S. This is what's called a spectral curve. And although we've written it out as zeta and c, this is a certain natural way to compactify to the Riemann sphere to express this spectral curve as a branched cover of the Riemann sphere. So that's, this complex curve is an object you can attach to a solution of Naum's equations. You can compute it for any value of s, and you get the same curve. And conversely, you can recover a solution of Naum's equations from your holomorphic geometry on your spectral curve. So, at least in principle, going through all that, you'd have a procedure for writing down, in terms of the sort of function theory of this compact Riemann surface, algebraic curve, the general solution of Naum's equations. So that's a digression. This is just a simple, this reduction to this ODE gives a simple way of illustrating this sort of integrable aspect of these instanton equations, which are one large part of their interest. But let's stop there. We'll go next time. We'll start. We'll get straight into this discussion of a variant of the ADHM construction for instantons on tori, and then the ADHM construction itself. And then maybe have time to say something about four manifolds and Seiberg-Witten equations.